So I want to share a couple of scriptures with you like we do. Kind of goes along with a couple of the songs today. First, from Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. This is, Revelation's got some cool worship moments. It says, "Worthy are you, O Lord, our Lord, our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of your will they existed and were created." And then I think you're probably all familiar with this one, but I think we know and quote John 3:16 very often, but we don't often go on to John 3:17. So I wanted to share that today. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him."
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Amen. You ready?
Yes.
Hopefully my music all stays on the stand.
Worthy, 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 worthy
seen for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Amen.
Highways, you're the only one who can.
nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
You turn graves into gardens.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can.
You're the only one.
By might, it's not by power, it's by the Spirit of the Lord. Only Jesus Christ is worthy of our praise. Amen. It was his sacrifice on the cross. His perfect sacrifice on that cross, and him going into the ground for 3 days and then rising again, taking back life, taking back victory over sin and death and the grave. It's only by his might, only by his sacrifice, and only by his life that we can be saved. He's worthy of all of our honor, all of our glory, all of our praise. You read about that in Revelation 4 this morning. Nothing else matters in this world. Nothing else is worthy of that kind of glory and honor.
Oh,
exalt thee one more time.
So last week, I got halfway through a sermon, and we were talking about my servant, the branch, from Zechariah 3:8. And you can, I called this to your attention last week, but I want to make sure you catch it now. In Zechariah 3:8 there, you see the symbol, see the word symbol? The men are a symbol for my servant, the branch. And, you know, Joshua is the high priest. He's the actual high priest. He's an actual person in Israel, 500 BC, somewhere 500 years before Jesus came. But he is a symbol. And this is a prophecy. And so Joshua is a symbol of my servant, the branch. And take a look at Jeremiah 23:5 plus a lot of other scriptures. We can certainly know and read and discern that Jesus is the branch, okay? Raise up for David a righteous branch. He will reign as a king, act wisely, do justice, righteousness in the land. And, of course, that is Jesus. And Isaiah also prophesied that, plus many others in the Old Testament. Then Zechariah 3:1, we looked at this last week. Just want you to remember that Satan, if he is bold enough to stand up and accuse Jesus, he's bold enough to come against us. And so don't ever think that, you know, there isn't an enemy that may want to come against you and certainly cause you difficulty and cause you heartache and pain. So, but he is real and he is out there. And then verse 2 now, in Zechariah 2, which we also looked at last week, this is a really good formula for dealing with the darkness. I know a lot of people like to pray. I have prayed. You may hear me pray again. The Lord, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. If you've ever heard anybody pray like that, you know, I come against the spirit, whatever, in the name of Jesus. And that's okay. That's not, but this is a really good formula here to use too. The Lord rebuke you, Satan, okay? I mean, I have faith and I believe in Jesus. And if I were to encounter a devil or darkness, I feel very confident that I could deal with it. I have, and I feel like I could. But, you know, still, the Lord rebuke you, Satan, is just a really good formula, you know, to use. And he will do that. Now, in verses 3 through 5, which is where we spent most of our time last week, we talked about the filthy garments that, you know, again, as a prophecy applies to Jesus. His filthy garments were on the cross. When Jesus was on the cross, he took our sin. And that sin was taken off of him when he rose up from the grave. And that festival robes were put on him. And then also, you know, the clean turban. And you see that when he comes again, you know, he has the white robes and he's dressed in festival garments. Then we applied this to us because, remember, prophecies have layers, right? Prophecy usually will apply to something that's going on right at the present time and somewhere in the future, and then maybe even farther than that and to different people as well. And in this case, as it applies to us, I take my filthy garments off when I get saved. When I you know, do away with my separation from God, I put festival robes on, and then my turban is my testimony. We talked about that last week, you know, that we go out and we live for Jesus, and that's a two-part, two separate acts there. You know, separation from God is taken away, and then I become a new creature. I put on my turban. And I didn't mention it last week, but I was thinking about it this week. Remember the parable in the Gospels when Jesus talked about the marriage festival, and he invited people to come to the marriage festival, and a bunch of people came, but it still was room, so they could go out and have other people came in. And then he was walking around and he discovered some people there that didn't have their festival robes on. Said, "What are you doing in here without your festival? You've got to get out." Well, you know, we have to be born again. We have to be saved. We have to have the blood of Jesus in our life. We have to take away our separation from God, or we're not going to spend eternity with God. And one other thing is, before we move on now, my turban is my testimony. I know I live for Jesus. Most of you here have surrendered your life to Christ. You live for Jesus. You try to do what's good. That's your testimony. That, you know, that's who you are. I'm a child of the living God. After we establish that, after we establish the fact that I've got my filthy garments off, I've got my turban off, well, what's next? You know, what's next? Outside these walls, there are an awful lot of people that still have their filthy garments on. They haven't taken their garments off. And when we get, when we leave this place, that's our job, that's our duty, that's our responsibility, our eyes to be open, looking for people that have these filthy garments on, and then trying to find a way to share with them and tell them to take the stupid garments off. Now, if you've done any witnessing at all, you've talked to anybody about Jesus, you've tried to get them to come to the Lord, that is not an easy prospect. It's very difficult to get people to see that they're lost and get them to accept Jesus Christ and come to him. It's not easy at all. But it's our responsibility. It's our job. It's what my turban is for. It's what my witness is for. When anyone's just supposed to be a good witness for Jesus so I can say, oh, I'm a good witness for Jesus. I think I'll get up and look in my mirror today and see, oh, I'm a wonderful witness for Jesus. I admire myself so much. I'm here for a reason. I'm here for a purpose. To let somebody else know that they need to take those filthy garments off. And that can only happen through prayer. And so today I want to issue a challenge. Before I move on with Zechariah, the Tuesday prayer group, those of you that come and pray on Tuesday, I would like you to start praying for souls. Just pray for souls. Pray for lost people. Ask the Lord to save people, to show people that their garments are dirty. Saturday prayer meetings, begin to pray wholeheartedly for souls. Ask the King to release those people and that they can take their garments off and that they can be saved. And those of you that don't attend either one of those prayer meetings in your own prayer life and your own prayer time, I just want to challenge you, start praying for souls. Let's just be a church that prays for souls, for people to be saved, for people to come to Christ. Well, I don't care where they go to church, okay? That they need to come to Christ. They need to get their garments off. Amen. So I'm going to challenge you. Amen. I want to challenge you to do that. We went to that conference up there in Belvedere, and they talked about the power of one, how much one person can do. Just one person. Talking about Jesus, how powerful that is. One person having a clean turban on. One person going out into the darkness and letting their light shine. How powerful it is. All right, so let's move on now. Verse 7. Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, you will perform my service, then you will also govern my house, you will have charge of my courts. I will grant you free access among those who are standing here. Okay, this is directed to Joshua, of course, and, you know, it does have some bearing right there at the present time because they've just come back from captivity. Israel's been in Babylon in captivity by another nation for 70 years. They've come back into the land. They've rebuilt the temple, and, you know, it has application to them. You know, Joshua, if you will do what's right, you will have the nation of Israel will have access to my courts. If you're familiar with Israel's history at all, they never went back to idolatry after they came back from captivity. They were not doing what Jehovah wanted them to do. They got off the track, but they still were worshiping Jehovah. There was no Baal. There was no, you know, false idols, no false gods. They never went back to idol worship. So to a certain extent, you know, they did follow that. Now, we know also that Jesus accomplished all of this, right? Jesus walked in all the ways of the Lord. He did what he was supposed to do here on this earth. We saw that in John 17, and he surrendered his life back to the Lord and lived a perfect life and became a perfect sacrifice. And we know that. They, of course, did not. You know, they did not know that the servant branch was going to do what he did. They did not know that Jehovah was the branch. You know, they never got a hold of a grasp of that at all. They did not know that there was a suffering Messiah. The nation of Israel came to understand, govern my house as we're going to move the Romans out. The Romans are going to be pushed out. They're going to be set aside, and we're going to govern God's house here on this earth. That's how they came to understand it. And, of course, it was wrong. They never saw the suffering Messiah. But if you go back into Isaiah and, you know, 52, 53, and plenty of other places in the scripture, you know, where the Messiah was to suffer and the Messiah was to bring all people in. You know, if the Jews had had their way, they'd be over there in Israel right now, you know, with a temple worshiping God, and we wouldn't be part of it. They're no different than the Muslims as far as they're the only ones, the chosen ones. You know, there were no Gentiles in the courts of the Lord, and we're Gentiles. So it had to happen the way it happened, or we wouldn't have a place to go. Now, this prophecy, remember the prophetic layers, not only does it extend to Jesus, but I believe without any doubt it also extends to all believers. Amen. This is a call, this is a charge to anybody that will follow the Lord Jesus Christ. If you will walk in my ways. That's surrender. That's what surrender is. You know, I'm out, I'm walking in my own ways, I'm doing my own thing, and I just, you know, throw up my hands, I say, I surrender, I quit, I give up, I'm not going to do this on my own anymore, I belong to you, come in, you know, take my life, change my life, and just, I will follow you. Surrender, I'll walk in his ways. And when I got saved, I didn't know a first thing about God's ways. Not the first thing, did I? No, nothing. I knew nothing, absolutely nothing. But, you know what? I found him. I found God's ways. They're right here in this book. You know, the first time through the New Testament, never having read it before, I saw, oh my, well, I got to work on that, And even yet today, finding God's ways, they're right here. And in my secret places, I go to my secret place and I read and I pray and I study and I come to church and I worship and I serve here in church. Hey, what's that sound like? Plan A. In the Old Testament. Plan A in the Old Testament. Now, it said that they govern my house, right? Have charge of my courts. Have free access. Is that not the church? Amen. I mean, is that not... Who has access today? Hebrews 10. Gate thrown open. Who has access to the kingdom today? We do. The church. God's people. This is us. We're going to govern his house. We're here. This is his house. We're worshiping in his house. The gifts and the ministries are here. We have free access to the Spirit here, and we're going to do the work of the kingdom here on this earth. It's us.
Amen.
It's us. Okay. Revelations 20 and verse 4. We sang about these guys this morning, didn't we? So I saw the song, they sat on them. That's those 24 elders. 24 elders, 12 from the Old Testament, 12 from the New Testament, 12 tribes, 12 apostles, 24 elders. They sat on them. Those are the guys that jumped up, threw their crowns down. They're really cool. And you take a look at them through the book of Revelation. But remember now, prophetic layers, prophecies applying to different times. Right now, we have a partial fulfillment of governing his house. We have a partial fulfillment of having access into his courts, but it's not final. Somebody gave a word from the Lord this morning that Jesus was coming back, right? Somebody said that. Who was that? Helen, did you say that? And Jesus is coming back. And that's the final. And this is what this prophecy, you know, this is the fulfillment of Zechariah's prophecy here in Revelations 20 and verse 4. We've got this great company of saints that are going to be with Jesus when they come back. That's us. This company of saints, that's anybody that died in the service of the Lord. If you die before the Lord Jesus Christ comes back, you're in this company of saints. This is going to be all of the martyrs that have died for Christ all in the years. The tribulation saints are going to be in this bunch. We're going to be in this group. And they are all going to come, and they're going to reign with Jesus Christ for 1,000 years. And that 1,000-year period is called the millennium. When you read in the Bible, you see the word millennium, you talk about that. This is what that is. It's a 1,000-year period where we're all going to reign with Jesus Christ. And you see that came to life? What did we talk about a couple weeks ago from John 17? We are eternal creatures. We are eternal creatures. We from the time that we are conceived, we are eternal. And we have a choice of where we're going to spend that eternity. But they came to life, and then you see they reigned with Christ. Well, this is Zechariah's prophecy. This is to govern. This is to have charge of God's kingdom. Now, Revelations 21:3. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men. He will dwell among them. They shall be his people, and God himself shall be among them. This is the ultimate, final, complete fulfillment of Zechariah's prophecy. You're going to govern my house. You're going to have charge of my courts, and you're going to have free access. The plan of God is not made up as we go along.
Amen.
This Zechariah's prophecy was 500 years before Jesus Christ was born. And this is a prophecy that's yet 2,000 years old. It hasn't even been fulfilled yet. So we're talking about 2,500 years, but the plan has already been set. The plan has already been made. God doesn't make it up as he's going along. Doesn't get up every day and say, well, we need to call my National Security Council together. Or if he's running for election, he said, well, we're not doing too well in the polls, so we got to make some changes today. It's all set. It's all figured. It's all there. And he knows it. And we are the plan. It's us. We're the plan.
Amen.
You know, God didn't have a plan B. He just had a plan A. Took 11 men, and they elected another one, let's just call them 12. Took 12 men, sent them out to preach the gospel, and that was the plan. There was no other plan. And if that plan would have failed, we wouldn't be here today. But we are the plan. We are God's plan. We are the church, and we're doing what we're supposed to be doing by coming here, worshiping, and going out there and telling people about Jesus. That's the plan. One, the power of one, one person. We're it. And when it's all over with, when it's all done and said, we are going to reign. I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe you have visions, right? You have visions. You want to be a mayor. You want to be a governor. I don't know. How do you want to reign? This and that. I would like to be a fishing guide, you know. Maybe up Lake Saskatchewan, you know, up there, the thousands and thousands of acres up there. And this be my reign. I'm reigning over this dock. I tell you. You got to do something, right? Hey, let's let the world handle it. We got an election coming up, right? Does anybody here old enough to remember that we didn't even think about presidential elections till summer was over?
That's right.
Well, I mean, no, we don't. You know, when summer was over, then you, excuse me, summer was over, you'd start thinking, well, I guess we got to go vote here in 2 or 3 months. They start running for office right after they get elected, you know. But let's let the world handle the politics. We got some business of the church. There's some people out there with dirty garments on. Let's take care of that. Let the world. They can handle their own politics. I don't know. Sometimes I think, you know, the Christians think they're supposed to be Republican precinct committeemen. You know, as soon as an election rolls around, they're supposed to run out and get everybody to vote for Republicans. Now, I don't have any problem with that. I mean, go ahead. You know, that's fine. Go ahead and do that. But, you know, your job is to be the church.
Amen.
Let the world take care of that stuff. Let's take care of what's important. All right. The last two verses here. I have set a stone before Joshua. That stone is the cornerstone. The cornerstone is Jesus. Three times in the Gospels, four more times in the New Testament, Jesus is called the stone. He's the cornerstone of the building. And he's just the cornerstone. He's not the building. He's the cornerstone. We are the building. First Peter chapter 2, what? You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, one stone built upon another into a spiritual house. We are the house of God. He's the cornerstone, but we're the house. And everything needs to revolve around him. And you know what else he is? He's also the stone that the builders rejected, and he became a stumbling stone. You're watching this on YouTube, you're watching this on Facebook or something, you have to make a choice. There is a cornerstone, and you can be built on the house. You can surrender your life to Jesus. You can lay down your sins, and you can be part of God's plan and part of the church, or you're going to be on the outside, and that's a stumbling stone. And you're going to have dirty clothes, and when you get to heaven, you're not going to get in. He's the Messiah that they missed. They absolutely missed him. Now, he has seven eyes, okay? Seven eyes. Those seven eyes are found in Revelations 5:6. Those seven eyes represent the seven spirits of God. I believe they're a symbol. I believe that's symbolic. I don't expect to go up to heaven and see a lamb with seven eyes. Okay, I believe it's symbolic of the seven spirits of God. The seven spirits of God are, that's a completion. Seven is a perfect number. The completion of God's spirit, the completion of the works of God being done on this earth. And then he has an inscription. Has an inscription engraved on the stone, okay? Now, the inscription could be several things. First of all, there was an inscription on the cross, right? Yeah. This is the King of the Jews. This is, and remember the apostles wanted to take that down. Not the apostles, but the Sanhedrin said, take that down. We don't want to sign over him, says he's the King of the Jews. Put it up and says, he said he was the King of the Jews. And what was Pilate's response? What I have written, I have written, okay? And so Jesus had an inscription above the King of the Jews. We will have an inscription on our foreheads. Is he going to have a new name? Not like that. It's going to be a nice inscription. It's not going to be, you know. And it'll have a name on it. It'll be the God's name on our forehead, and we don't know what that is. We're going to have a new name. We don't know what that is. It could also be the name of Jesus, the King of Kings. Remember, he comes back, King of Kings, Lord of Lords is on it. So it could be that. There are several inscriptions that it could be. So we don't. That you can't totally, absolutely figure out what the inscriptions, what the eyes are. You don't really, it's not, you know, told. But one thing that's sure in this prophecy, I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. Amen. There's a partial iniquity removed now. I've had my iniquity's been removed partially. You know, I've been serving the Lord, you know, 50 years now. I'm in, you know, I'm pretty good shape. Right? You're going to keep me, right?
I'm thinking of
it. Oh. See how they are? Yeah. 58 years, and she's still thinking it over. The partial removing of the iniquity. You know, we surrendered our life to Jesus, or you know, we became a new creature in Christ. The old man passed away. The new man came. But yet there's still evil. There's still trouble in this land. There's still difficult. Hey, I'll tell you what. I'll give some points away. I'll give 3 points away. Now, remember this contest. You have to raise your hand. Okay? And also remember that I am what? I am the Lord of the contest. This is subjective. What I say goes, you know. If you can't buy by those rules, don't raise your hand. I mean, if you're going to come up and give an answer and I'm going to say no and you're going to get mad, then don't raise your hand because that's a possibility, right?
That's a possibility.
Why is there still iniquity? Now, this is so specific. I'm looking for one word. Why is there still iniquity in this land? Ah, Miss Diana Bickerman has her hand up. She thinks she knows the answer. Yes. We've been given a choice. Sorry. Now, that's true, but that's not the answer. Ah, Sandra's going to take a shot.
Sin.
All right. 1 point. 1 point. You get, because you're close. Oh, yeah, 3 points. And because of his last name, give him a bonus, 4 points. The curse. We live on a cursed earth. This is a cursed land. And no matter how holy we become, no matter how much the Holy Spirit pours out his power, no matter how many gifts, no matter how good the church does, this earth is still cursed. And in Revelation 21, when Jesus Christ comes back to this earth and he sets up his kingdom, it says there will be no more curse.
Amen.
I'm free from the sin. I don't have to make a choice anymore. I made my choice. I'm in the right spot.
Amen.
And look what it says. Everyone sits under his vine. And under his fig tree. That's our future. A lot of you know that Carol and I built a porch on the back of our house. And the screened-in porch. And one of the reasons, there are several reasons, but one of the reasons we built it is that where we moved to in Chillicothe, when we moved back to town, I didn't have any place to watch storms. I'm a storm watcher. I mean, I love storms. I mean, if a storm's around, I want to see it. This week we had some storms come through, didn't we? Huh? One of those little thunderstorms came right across Chillicothe It came right across Bradley. It came right across that 80-acre field across from the high school, that empty field. And I was sitting on my porch, and I watched that thing come, and the lightning was across the sky, and the booms, and we had hail, and we had rain. I tell you, it was awesome. I was sitting under my vine. I was sitting under my fig watching a thunderstorm. After Carol and I retired, we spent 5 months up at the lake. And for 5 months, I sat on my porch and watched the sun come up on that lake every day. I never left. We stayed there 5 months. She tried to drag me home. See how much influence, huh? Yeah. Did you want to go home? Here's the keys. I don't care. As nice as those 5 months were, sitting on that porch watching that sun, and as cool as that thunderstorm was coming across that yard, coming across that field the other night, it doesn't even compare to sitting under my vine and my fig tree in heaven. Amen. With the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.